Do you know a lot of kids that would not say they were shy until they got to like high school, middle school though too?
Yeah, that's true.
I feel like even the kids that weren't shy, mm-hmm. they would be like, yeah, I was really shy in seventh grade. And I'd be like, I was your seventh grade social studies teacher. You were not shy. You were a little dick.
Remember what I was telling you just a second ago before we got in here?
Yeah, I remember when you were extremely rude and mean and you were so angry at me because I was singing Rent in the Styles of Roger. I don't remember that guy's name.
Adam Pascal.
Adam Pascal. I was singing it in perfect harmony with him.
It was a really good impression. But I said, you better knock that off right now.
One song, one last refrain. Me, me. He doesn't sing me, me, but you can imagine if he did.
I can't imagine if he did.
Rach, how would you sing Adam Pascal?
I wouldn't.
You give me your impression.
I wouldn't sing it because I know better.
You. I want to hear you.
Time flies, time dies. I don't know. I'm not meant to sing that.
Yeah.
Hey, welcome.
Hey, welcome.
Oh, this is my last one.
Yeah, thank goodness, right? Am I right, listeners? Her episodes have been such a bore.
Oh, pish posh. I've loved every second of my episodes.
No, you know, I've gotten a lot of feedback the last couple weeks, and people say like, yeah, I really enjoyed your episodes, Ty. I usually skip Rach's, but I've really enjoyed yours.
Nobody said that.
Yeah, they do.
No, they don't.
They say that.
They don't say that. If they say it, they better say it to my face next time.
Oh, well, maybe you should have the podcast under your name then, because they only know to talk to me.
Ty, what did we watch this week?
We watched The Birdcage. All one word, right?
Yes.
Not two words?
It's not two words.
Not birdcage.
It's the.
Compound noun.
And then birdcage. Yep.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Yep. 1996. What were you up to in 1996?
Oh my gosh, I was in third grade. You know what's so funny? I didn't know when this movie was filmed.
Really?
I was so lost in like what time period we were in. I kept thinking, okay, this is maybe late 80s. There's a lot of like Reagan comments, but then they mentioned Clinton. Mm-hmm. And I was like, okay, now I think we're in the early 90s. And I kept thinking, okay, is this before or after Mrs. Doubtfire? Like that's what I kept wrestling with in my head. Is this before Mrs. Doubtfire or after Mrs. Doubtfire?
And did you answer it?
No, I don't remember what Mrs. Doubtfire was. I think it was right after.
It was. This was after Mrs. Doubtfire because I was in 93.
Oh,
actually.
That was okay. So we were like in first grade at that point, or kindergarten.
Sure.
And so that movie, because I always think Mrs. Doubtfire, when that happens, Robin Williams explodes. Mm-hmm. Like he's in Jack. He's in, that's a great example of his explosion.
Is that?
Yep.
Most people
tremendous
would go with
movie.
Like Jumanji or.
Jumanji, yep, another good one. Yep, lots of great movies. And so I wonder when, do you know when Hook was?
Mm-hmm.
When's Hook?
91.
Oh, so Hook was before Mrs. Doubtfire.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we're just in general a wash of Robin Williams is ruling the world, kind of.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. We'll get into his ebbs and flows, and mostly flows, because really, once he took off, he was pretty much in something every year of note until he didn't want to be anymore.
Did you ever see that movie RV?
That is not on my list of films that I grabbed from him. Have you ever seen
RV? I think that's the last movie I ever saw that he did. It was awful.
Yeah.
It was like trying to be National Lampoon's Christmas Vacation or like any of the vacation movies. Mm-hmm. And it just was just a train wreck of a movie. And he couldn't save it either. It was just, wow. This is wild.
He did what he could. Oh, The Birdcage.
Yeah.
I'm trying to think of the first time I saw this. And I'll be honest, I don't know that I've actually ever seen it uncensored.
Oh.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's tons of F-bombs. There's...
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's always on TV.
It is?
That's when I've seen it.
Like on what channels? Just take a stab.
Like TBS?
Oh, okay.
Or TNT?
The Superstation.
The Superstations.
Yep.
I don't know. Is there
we
even
do
TNT
comedy
anymore?
On TBS.
Comedy Central, probably.
Okay.
Had it on there from a time or two.
Sure.
Yeah. I've only ever seen it on TV, I think.
Mm-hmm.
I'm pretty sure.
How do you feel about that? Did you like the uncensored version, or did you miss the TV reeling it in?
No, I like the uncensored version.
Yeah, I do too.
But it's also surprisingly very easy to censor.
Oh, sure.
For the most part.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah, it's mostly just language in it. There's a couple of things, but I think they, even like the statues and things like that, they leave everything, all of the phallic symbols
when she says the statues, she means statues with gigantic penises. It's amazing. Yeah, I always am curious. Do you, and I know some films do this differently, where sometimes they'll just censor it, like you'll just hear like a blank space, or they'll have like somebody comes in and they dub over the word with like a different word. But what I think is pretty crafty is when films know they're going to get censored, and so they say, hey, we got to film this scene again, only this is for our TV, like we need to redo it.
Oh.
Like I've seen some films do that too, and I think that's pretty clever.
I don't think they did that.
Seamless.
I think this is a dub over.
Yeah.
If not.
Or a blanks.
Yeah, or just blanks probably.
Okay.
If I recall.
Yep.
But this is, you're sure this is the first time that you've seen this? You've never seen this before?
Never.
Never.
Never. I didn't even know what it was about. I knew it had something to do with the LGBTQ community, and that was kind of it. And that was just based on like Nathan Lane and drag I had seen a picture of.
Sure.
And then I had seen Robin Williams, and I just thought, like, yeah, I think this is an LGBTQ movie, but that's all I knew.
All right. For the listeners who haven't seen this and are like, wait, what? What is this?
Wait,
what are you?
What?
What? What are you showing us this week? Ty, give us a synopsis of The Birdcage.
Okay. The Birdcage. Now, imagine this. We have an odd couple, kind of. We have Robin Williams, who owns a nightclub that puts on drag performances. He's gay. And we have Nathan Lane, who is the love of his life and is the star of the show. And so this is your couple. And Nathan Lane is very emotional.
He screams all the time.
Oh! Oh, my God! Are you crazy? What are you doing?
Stop screaming!
Yep. Yeah, for sure. And Robin Williams is more subdued.
Yeah.
And so that's kind of the dynamic you're dealing with, and as far as like the kind of the odd couple-y dynamic. So that's on one side. They have a kid, which I thought like was like, oh, they adopted a kid, or they went through surrogacy or something like that. But no, Robin Williams actually knocked up a gal when he was younger, the first time he had sex with a woman, just one time, and they ended up, she got pregnant, and then she didn't want to be a mom, and so she gave him the kid, and so that's his actual son, and Nathan Lane almost like adopted him and just loves the son.
Yes.
And so they have this son who has been away at college. He's 20 years old, and he found a college freshman, an 18-year-old, and they've been having sex for the last year. She tells her dad, Gene Hackman, who's a senator of a very Republican state. Like, imagine, like, Ted Cruz.
I think he's Ohio.
Yeah, he's Ohio. But, like, we're talking about he's a conservative.
Yeah.
Like, the most conservative person in the caucus, like, out of the, it's like him and another dude. So I put him like, he's a Tea Partier. He's like Ted Cruz. And so imagine Ted Cruz has this daughter who's 18 years old. And then there's these two gay guys who have a son and he's 20 years old. They meet at college. They fall in love. They start having sex all the time. And then they decide they're going to get married. It's pretty young. And
very, very young.
So now you have Ted Cruz, who is going in through Scandal. That's played by Gene Hackman.
Yep.
And they're going to get out of Ohio for a while, and they're going to go down and meet the parents to the person that their daughter's going to marry. And so then you have the hijinks that ensue as they try to figure out how are they going to survive this with the two different parents. And instead of this being like a God of Carnage, like parents like fighting thing, it's more about how can we hide on the Robin Williams, Nathan Lane side? How do we hide our gayness? And so then we can trick the conservative family into thinking we're like a normal family. So Nathan Lane's going to be like an uncle. And their gay friend who like helps out a lot is going to be like the butler and stuff. So they like each have these characters that they play and they practice being straight. Some of the best moments of the whole movie is like them practicing being straight. So funny. So funny. And yeah, hijinks ensue.
Hijinks ensue as it unravels.
Yep. You're just leading up. Like, everything is in preparation for this big dinner scene, and you're just waiting for the climactic scene for, like, 75% of the movie. It's, like, this huge buildup.
Yeah. Does it feel very much like it is a play? Like, could you see it being a play?
Well, I mean, I know Lacage is what it's based off of. It says that at the end. It says, yes. La Cage aux Folies.
Yes. La Cage aux Folies, 1973, a play, a French farce.
Yeah.
By Jean Piorot.
Piorot?
Piorot.
P-I-E-R-O-T?
P-O-I-R-E-T?
Pure. Oh, maybe I have it opposite.
Pure.
Okay.
Pure. Jean Pure.
Yep, okay.
Is the author of the French farce, La Cage aux Folies.
Yeah, very good.
I don't even think you say the S.
I don't think you say the S either. I messed it up first.
French
I said the precedence.
It's hard. But yeah, that is when. Do you know anything about that? It's pretty similar. It's not too far off.
The musical, La Cage, has gotten really popular in the last, like, I don't know, 8 years? Mm-hmm. I don't think it's been out a crazy long time. Mm-hmm. But, like, when it came out, theaters started producing it pretty quickly. So it must be a hot ticket.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it's pretty similar to this. The play itself, from which all of these are based on, takes place actually in Saint-Tropez, France, instead of South Beach.
Yep.
So it really just that, and then our film takes place in South Beach, Florida. Mm-hmm. So very fun, very bright, very vibrant, very Cuban. We love it.
Yep.
A lot of Gloria Estefan.
Otherwise, the play and the movie are pretty much like the same exact
the
plot
concept
line.
Like is the, similar. Like who's coming to dinner? Okay, we have to like it's a gay couple and we have to hide our gayness.
Yes, yes.
And so silliness ensues. In 1978, it was actually made into a film first. Mm-hmm. Also by the same name, La Cage. But then it also had two sequels after it as well.
I'm just checking to make sure, like, do you have when the musical came out?
The musical in 1983?
Yeah, it was earlier than I thought. Mm-hmm. Harvey Fierstein. Oh, okay. Very exciting.
Yeah, I wonder if the music's good.
Yeah, I've only heard a couple songs from it, and I thought they seemed pretty cool.
Well, the story is very fun and very silly, very farcy, so I would imagine, like, if you just don't mess it up too much. But I think, I don't know. A musical would be fun, but a play version of this would also be very fun.
Oh,
I think
for sure.
It can pretty much take place all in your Saint-Tropez location or your South Beach location.
Yep, just do
and then we
set.
Just know that they're coming and that the dinner is going to happen. It feels very like God of Carnage, right? There's going to be this big dinner, and then that's the whole climax of the play.
Mm-hmm.
So fun.
Yep.
Some taglines for this bad boy. Come as you are.
Okay.
That's it.
I like to think, is there a double entendre?
It's
there?
No double entendre, you pervy perv. Just regular as you are. another one. What could possibly come between a match made in heaven, the parents, dinner, and a nightclub called the Birdcage?
Mm-hmm. Okay.
The director of said play, Mike Nichols.
Okay.
Have you heard of him before?
I mean, I know a Mike Nichols.
Is it the same person?
No. But I know him and I enjoy
him. He has directed in the past Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf.
Oh. Mm-hmm.
And also The Graduate. Those are kind of his two claim to fames.
Those are shot very differently. Like, those movies make sense to me that it's the same director.
Yeah.
But this movie is a little bit of a departure and just different, the shooting. Like, you commented on some of the cinematography. There's this opening scene that starts off in the ocean, and it's like a helicopter shot is what I was assuming because there were no drones back then.
Yeah.
And so you got this, like, helicopter shot, and it's almost like somehow the camera got transferred to somebody on the ground or, like, they did a cutaway that I just couldn't tell where it was.
Yeah.
And so it zoomed in, and then it was, like, on a track, and it went all the way into the club, and people are, like, walking around it. And it went all the way up to the stage, and it was like a breathtaking shot. Yeah. I don't understand how it happened.
Yeah, that shot actually, so it's made to look like it's one. It is three shots technically.
Oh, okay.
But they were very tricky in the editing with how they passed it from shot to shot.
Yeah, so, okay.
Yeah, you are right. Mm-hmm. It is a cool shot.
Yeah, very cool.
Mike Nichols' other claim to fame, he was married to Diane Sawyer.
Oh, really?
Yep.
I wonder if he ever gave her shit about all her mean questions to Britney.
Yeah, you think he called her to task
on
that?
Why are you being such a dick to Britney right now?
How could you say that?
Ask her about her virginity every other question.
Yeah, that's pretty messed up.
Yep.
We cringe now, but we wanted to know then.
we for sure wanted to know.
Well, I wasn't going to ask. So Mike Nichols, earlier on in his career in the 50s and 60s, he was a part of a comedy duo, an improv comedy duo, with an Elaine May. Now, the two of them teamed up to adapt the play, La Cage, mm-hmm. to this film. Or rather, to remake La Cage for an American audience. Mm-hmm. Because before it was a French foreign film, which did very well, too, I should say, at the Oscars. I think it won Best Foreign Film that year.
Oh, okay.
And that came out. So anyways, the two of them teamed up again mm-hmm. and decided that they were going to remake it. Some filming behind the scenes. Steve Martin was actually supposed to be the original Armand for this. Armand was played by
Robin Williams. He would have been good. He would have been really good.
Mm-hmm. And then Robin Williams was going to play the Nathan Lane role.
Oh, those two together? That would have been wild.
That would have been cool.
Yeah.
Steve Martin had some scheduling conflicts, and it turns out that Robin said he actually didn't really want to play Albert because he had already dressed in drag for Mrs. Doubtfire.
Yes.
So he felt like he had. And I like him as the. I'm not going to say straight man. I don't mean straight as in like gay or homosexual. I mean straight as in like
the goofier one plays off the straight
yes,
man.
Yes, yeah. Yep. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I have a whole section on Robin Williams, but his breath and genre, just what he does mm-hmm. is there's so much there, right?
Yeah,
he can
for
be
sure.
manic and insane in spots and then so subdued and so simple mm-hmm. in others. So.
Like in Jack.
Just bring it back to Jack.
Can we talk about it? The best movie he's ever done, which is Jack with J-Lo. Do you remember J-Lo's in the movie?
J-Lo's in that?
She's the love interest / teacher.
That's weird.
Yeah, because he's growing up. It gets weird. There's some weird scenes in that.
Oh, that's really weird.
Yeah.
Oh, I don't think I want to do a rewatch of that.
It's a little bizarre.
That's messed up. Nope, no thanks. On set, there was an improv rule.
Mm-hmm.
The improv rule is you have to do the screen or the script written with how it is until the director was satisfied with it, and then they got to do some improv.
Then you
got to
play.
And then you got to play a little bit, but they were not allowed to do that until they got it in the can with the script.
I like that. That's mm-hmm. nice because it's like I have two actors who are extremely mm-hmm. well connected to who they are as humans and can probably do great improv, but I need to make sure we don't fly off the handle. So mm-hmm. you do it my way, and then we do it your way.
Yeah.
And then we see what works, and it's probably a combination. I'm guessing it was probably the middle takes.
Yeah, probably.
I had a guess. It's probably like, yeah, that one flew off too much off the handle,
mm-hmm.
and we lost the point.
Mm-hmm.
But those middle ones, there's something magic about
mm-hmm.
those.
Yeah, you're not quite all the way out there yet.
Mm-hmm.
The director, Nichols, had to move his chair into another room because he laughed too much.
Oh, okay.
And he ruined the sound for a lot of them, especially the scene where Nathan Lane is learning how to spread or smear toast.
Yes, the toast spreading scene.
Tell us a little bit about toast spreading.
Oh my gosh, that's one of my favorite scenes of the entire movie. They're at this like random restaurant, and Robin Williams is coaching Nathan Lane on how to be like more straight, how to be more masculine,
mm-hmm.
and so they do like the whole walking thing, but then there's this whole bit with toast
mm-hmm.
where he's already tried to teach him how to walk and how to talk. And now they take their toast and he like is grabbing a spoon, I think, and like kind of like throwing some jam,
like dabbing, it
dabbing
on
some jam on there. He's like, no, you don't take it. Straight people, they smear.
Men smear.
So he takes like a knife and he's smearing it all over. And then Nathan Lane's like, yeah, we smear. It's funny when he like repeats the stuff back to him and he takes it and he punctures the toast and he screams, he goes, ah! And he's like, no, forget about the toast, F the toast. He throws it over, he's like, yeah, F the toast.
We could get more toast.
We can get more toast.
Don't use the spoon and don't dribble little dots of mustard.
No?
No. You take your knife and you smear. Men smear.
Smear,
that's it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Get the goddamn pinky down. All right, make your fingers like iron, all right? Yeah, and stop trembling. Hold the knife boldly and strength.
How can I pierce the toast?
So what?
The important thing to remember is not to go to pieces when that happens.
You have to react like a man. Calmly. You have to say to yourself, Albert, you pierced the toast. So what? It's not the end of your life. Try another one.
Albert, you pierced the toast. So what?
You're right. There's no need to get hysterical. All I have to remember is I can always get more toast.
But yeah, so the director couldn't be on set for that and then was in a different room, and then sometimes they put a blanket over his head. I don't know why.
To muffle the sound, probably.
I think so. So you can hide in there.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, which would be fun. So a little bit of a spoiler. When Nathan Lane dresses in drag as a mom,
yes.
as Val's mom, yep. and tries to play that off, did you think that she looked like anybody in particular? Any political...
She wears all pink. She's
yeah.
got blonde hair. Big blonde hair.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, don't get stuck on the blonde and don't get stuck on the pink.
Oh, well, how am I going to know who it is
then? Maybe just like the hairstyle itself. Did that remind you of anybody?
I mean, I'm assuming it was supposed to be like Nancy Reagan?
Ah, close. No, Barbara Bush.
Barbara Bush. Barbara oh, okay.
Bush.
Okay.
Yes, Mrs. Goldman's drag was based off of Barbara Bush.
Oh, gotcha. Okay.
Oh, my gosh. Let's get into a little bit of casting, shall we?
Yes.
Do you want to start with Robin or Nathan?
Let's start with Robin.
Oh, Robin. One of the greatest comedians of all time.
Yes.
I would say. He is technically number 13 on Comedy Central's 100 Greatest Stand-Ups.
Ooh, I wonder who's ahead of him.
I know. And this has stand-ups.
Oh,
it doesn't
stand-ups,
say
comedian. So not comedic
it's
actors.
Just
or...
the stand-up itself, which,
yep.
I mean,
well, have
sense.
You ever seen his stand-up?
I've seen some of his stand-ups before. That's
it's insane.
Crazy. Yeah.
It's actually... a little off-putting how crazy he is in mm-hmm. his stand-up. It, mm-hmm. like, kind of scares me a little bit.
Yeah.
He's, like, almost unhinged.
Yeah.
And he yep. sweats profusely. He's got, like, 1,000 cups of water all over a table. Mm-hmm. And he's, like, drinking and, like, pouring it on himself, like, throughout. And he's so dirty.
Mm.
Like, so dirty.
Oh, dirty in the sense of what he's talking about.
Yeah. Like, his comedy is so...
yeah.
profane. It's mm-hmm. wild. You're just like, whoa, Robin Williams.
What?
This is nuts. It's kind of like Bob Saget from Full House.
Yeah,
he's got like the dirtiest stand-up ever, mm-hmm. and you're like, you're the dad from Full House. There was a little bit of that with Robin Williams when
well,
I watched
right.
his stand-up.
Because you grew up and he was always the voice of Genie
yeah.
or, you know,
Stuffire.
Yeah, Hook, all yep. those pieces. So, yeah, that's hard to mm-hmm. see your heroes be...
who they are.
Adult men.
Yep.
Yep.
Be who they are.
Well, and that's actually how he made his start, was doing stand-up.
Mm-hmm.
Let's start with early life. So he was, he grew up in Chicago, just outside, but lived in both Detroit and California.
Mm-hmm.
He was a shy kid until high school drama.
Yes.
Probably that's the same for a lot of people.
Yeah.
I think I've said that before.
Do you know a lot of kids that would not say they were shy until they got to like high school, middle school, though, too?
Yeah, that's true.
I feel like even the kids that weren't shy, mm-hmm. they would be like, yeah, I was really shy in seventh grade. And I'd be like, I was your seventh grade social studies teacher. You were not shy. You were a little dick. And so I just wonder if that's the thing that we all say about ourselves in the past. Like, yeah, I was really shy until I opened up and became a butterfly in high school.
In high school, he was voted funniest and also most likely not to succeed.
Oh, gotcha. So he's the class clown, probably.
That's what that sounds like to me.
I wasn't the class clown, but I studied him.
And I learned his methods.
Shout out to Waiting for Guffman.
Yeah, callback.
You do an eclectic celebration of the dance. You do fussy, fussy, fussy. You do Martha Graham, Martha Graham, Martha Graham. Or Twyla, Twyla, Twyla. Or Michael Kidd, Michael Kidd, Michael Kidd, Michael Kidd. Or Madonna, Madonna, Madonna. But you keep it all inside. All right.
He went to college at Claremont Men's College, where he studied political science, but then later dropped out to go to a community college in California to study... theater.
Oh, yeah.
So he did a couple years there before he got his full scholarship to Juilliard.
Oh, of course. He's a Juilliard kid. Everybody's a Juilliard and an NYU kid. I think you guys can just suck it.
His classmates were Mandy Patinkin.
Okay.
And Christopher Reeves.
Wow.
He and Christopher Reeves were actually very, very good friends.
I remember that in the documentary after his death.
Do
they
you?
Talked about those two being super close.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
It's very different, right?
Yep.
Very different. But Christopher Reeves would talk about how, you know, you would have this guy who was just so manic and just out there in certain scenes and just so crazy, but then... I don't remember what play it was, but there was some play that he played an old man, and
mm-hmm.
and Reeves just said, oh my God, like he was the old man. He was just so subdued, and he just became that character.
Mm-hmm.
And so those were moments when I think his fellow actors were like, whoa, there's more to this guy than just, you know, his brilliant, you know, comedic brain.
Mm-hmm.
Like he's not just about improv and making people laugh. Like he's actually a very, very brilliant actor.
Sure. Yeah.
He was so brilliant that he was actually encouraged to leave Juilliard from his teachers. There were several teachers who told him, we've taught you as much as we can, and our style, our classical style, doesn't mm-hmm. suit you.
Yeah.
It said, this is, if anything, this is going to do more harm than good for what you want to do and what you need to do. Mm-hmm. So they actually encouraged him to leave. And so towards the end of his junior year, he dropped out of Juilliard.
Oh, wow.
Okay. I know. He was so close. Mm-hmm. Didn't finish.
Yeah, that's so close. I think those teachers were dumb. Yeah. If he only had a year left, as a teacher, you just say like, hey, you have one more year. Mm-hmm. I want you to finish your degree. Mm-hmm. And then you're gonna do other stuff. You're not going to do classical work. You know, mm-hmm. there's things you could tell him. Let him get his degree if he's only a year away.
Yeah.
If he was 3 years away, that's different. Mm-hmm.
And I think, too, as a professor, I think, how can I make this last year benefit you then?
Yeah,
for sure.
If I
don't want you to leave, but let's do something different. Let's figure out other classes for you to take that maybe suit your needs better.
Yep.
You know, tailor it a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
So he moved out to San Francisco, where he started his stand-up career, did a lot of stand-up, and then finally in 1978, he landed a role on a TV show. Do you know what TV show that he got his big break on? He's an alien.
Yes.
Does that help?
What's it called? Oh, I do know. I don't remember the name of it, though.
It's called Mork and Mindy.
Mindy, yes, yes, Mork. Yes, yes.
Yes. So that, and it really took off from there. He started kind of exploding again, doing more stand-up, but then got into the movie biz from that side.
Mm-hmm.
Marriages. Do you know how many times he's been married?
I'm gonna guess 4.
Close. 3 times.
Okay.
His first marriage lasted for about 5 years and he had a son.
Mm-hmm.
Second marriage was actually the former nanny from the first marriage.
Oh, it was one of those.
Yeah, it was one of those. Yep. They both maintained that the relationship didn't start till after the divorce.
Okay.
They were married for 21 years.
Oh, shoot.
And have 2 kids.
Mm-hmm.
And then he was finally married again. This is in 2011. He was married until he died. So mm-hmm. that was just about 3 years, I think.
Okay.
With his third wife.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So there you have that. So what did I say? 3 kids?
3 kids.
Yeah,
yep.
3 kids.
1 from the first, 2 from the second.
Mm-hmm. I think he has 2 sons and 1 daughter. And his daughter's name is Zelda.
Oh, cool.
And she is named
after the game.
After the game.
Wow.
That is a fact.
That's so cool. And his other 2 kids? Link and Ganondorf.
Whoa.
Yeah.
Can you imagine?
Really crazy.
Or...
Well, and the funny thing is, Link's kind of a dick, and Ganondorf's the sweetest kid you'll ever meet.
That would be crazy.
They defy their namesakes.
His first big film, I actually had never heard of this before as a film. In 1980, Disney made a live-action Popeye.
Oh, I've seen that movie.
You've seen it?
Yeah, yeah. The girl in the Olive in it, I think, is the gal from The Shining.
Could be. She would make a great Olive.
Pretty sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've seen that movie.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's Popeye.
Mm-hmm.
What did you think?
I mean, I was a kid, so I loved it.
You loved it?
I thought it was the best movie of all time.
At that time, it was the best movie of all time.
Yep, for sure.
Well, that's fine, because you weren't even born yet.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was -7.
-7. In 1987 was Good Morning Vietnam.
Mm-hmm. I've never seen that, but mm-hmm. I've heard of it.
Yep. I think he was nominated a couple of times for that as well. And then
he got nominated multiple times.
Oh my gosh, babe. I skipped that part. We should talk about it. Yeah. So Oscars, you know what his Oscar win was?
Mrs. Doubtfire, duh.
That would have been great.
What was his Oscar for?
His Oscar was for Good Will Hunting.
Oh, yeah. That makes sense. Yep.
But he was also nominated for Good Morning Vietnam, Dead Poets Society.
Oh, wow.
Mm-hmm. One of your faves.
One of my favorite movies of all time. Mm-hmm. If you ever wanted to get into education and you were like, yeah, what's it like to be a teacher? Pop in that film. That's not what it's like to be a teacher, but that's what you should strive for. You should strive to have a moment. And I had that moment one time in class when I was getting ready to turn the position back over to their usual 7th grade social studies teacher. Mm-hmm. They stood on their desks and they saluted me. And I literally started shouting for glee. It was amazing.
That was, yeah, I remember you talking about that.
Yep.
That
and you said, moment. I think they just wanted to stand on their desks. And I said, doesn't matter.
It doesn't matter. Either way. And they would have stood on their desks for you.
Oh, thanks, sweetie.
You were loved. You were loved. The third time that he was nominated was for a movie called The Fisher King.
Oh, I don't know that one.
I don't know that one either. Other than his Oscars, he has 2 Emmys, 6 Globes, 2 SAGs, and 5 Grammys. I think most of the Grammys are from the recordings of his shows.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. His stand-up
shows. That makes sense.
Yeah, technically, had he just gotten a Tony, he could have been an EGOT.
Yep. And, you know, I feel like Tonys usually come later in the careers for some of these film stars. Mm-hmm. Like, they do the film thing for so long, yeah. and then it's like their career starting to go down a little bit. And so mm-hmm. they're like, Broadway comes and it's like, hey, do you want to do this? Mm-hmm. And you're like, yeah, I'll do that. Yeah. And then you get your Tony.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I think it's hard, too, because he was based out of San Francisco for much of his life, too. So if he wasn't really willing to do the New York thing, then mm-hmm. then Broadway is going to have to just wait. You yep. know? Other of his movies that you love?
I think we mentioned most of them yeah. that come to mind.
We talked about Hook. We talked about... Yep. We didn't talk about Aladdin.
He's great in Hook. Oh, my gosh. There's the voice of the genie. There is no better voice acting performance. I'm going to just throw this out there right now.
Yeah, do it.
There's no better voiceover acting performance mm-hmm. than Robin Williams as the genie. Mm. This is the best voice acting you could ever hear in your entire life. Mm-hmm. It's not only crisp, and he not only understands his instrument to like the strongest degree a human being could possibly understand how their voice works, mm-hmm. but also just the amazing specificity and mm-hmm. detail and technique that he uses for each of these voices.
Yeah.
Incredible.
Yeah.
It's amazing.
I agree.
Why? 10,000 years will give you such a crick in the neck. Hang on a second. Whoa! Wow! Does it feel good to be out of there?
1992 is when that came out.
Oh, trust me, I remember. I was in kindergarten.
I mean, the role was essentially written for him.
Yeah. Yep.
And then I say written, but I'm going to put air quotes on that because so much of it was his improv mm-hmm. as well. So basically he did the role because he wanted to be a part of the animation tradition. He wanted something for his kids to be able to see, but he had a deal that he did not want Disney to sell anything based off of his character, the genie. So nothing from Burger King, no toys, none of that stuff. He didn't want anything. He didn't want to like make money or have that be like a cash cow.
Yep.
Well,
they didn't do that because I have a genie figure with multiple heads. Like you can like turn him and put a different head on him.
You are right. They did not follow through with what they had promised him and that they would not sell that. So the next movie comes.
Yes.
Return of Jafar.
Yes, Return of Jafar.
Guess whose voice is not on the genies?
Robin Williams.
That's right, babe.
Wow.
Y'all. He said, nope,
no
I'm
way.
Not doing it.
No way, Josue.
You broke your word, you sold stuff, and now I'm not doing it. It was done by Dan, I should know this name. He's the voice of Homer Simpson.
Oh.
Castellaneta?
Okay.
If I just say it fast, it'll work. You
yeah,
know.
Yeah, I know who you're talking about, but I don't know how to say his name either.
Yes. Voice of Homer. He did that.
Oh, okay.
Later, down the line,
yes.
Guess who comes crawling back to Robin Williams with an apology?
Yeah, for Prince of Thieves.
Yeah, the new CEO
of
Disney comes to Robin Williams and says, hey, we issued an apology. We're really sorry that we broke your trust. Will you please,
come back.
Please
we're gonna have Aladdin's dad in this next one. It's gonna be wild.
It's gonna be great.
It's gonna literally blow everyone's minds.
Yes. So essentially he says, okay, I'll come back. And he does it again.
Oh, gotcha.
Yeah.
Cool.
So but now I'm curious. Now I want to go back to Return of Jafar and see if I can hear it. I bet I can.
I don't remember. That doesn't stick out to me. I only saw Return of Jafar as a kid. Mm-hmm. But that doesn't stick out to me as something I really remembered.
Yeah.
Like, genie I remember
weird.
When he was gone. No, I didn't remember anything.
Yeah.
I was just an idiot kid, though.
Just an idiot kid. Well, and so that was, so we had Hook, 91, Aladdin, 92, Miss Doubtfire, 93, Jumanji, 95, mm-hmm. this movie, 96, Good Will Hunting, 97, Flubber.
Oh, Flubber. 97. Oh, that brings me back to our little hypothetical about me with Short Circuit versus the Flubber Kid. And
well,
you picked Flubber Boy.
Now that I remembered that he's in Flubber, I think I still pick Flubber.
You really went with Flubber Boy. You went with Troy and Flubber. Oh, how's Troy? That's when I ran into you on the street. Oh, hey, Rach. How's Troy?
What's that from?
I don't know. It's just that's the person that's your new lover.
That's the name, though?
Yeah.
Troy?
Yep.
He looks like a Troy.
Oh, he's an idiot. Flubber Kid. He's got Tommy Hilfiger jeans he wears 5 days a week because he's so cool.
A couple more things for Robin Williams. Later in his life, He credits cycling as helping him to stay sober.
I remember that. He's a huge cyclist.
Big cycle fan. Yep. It was after, and this was kind of earlier on, he was really addicted to cocaine around the time that John Belushi died.
Mm-hmm.
And that really helped sober him up. So he later went on to have problems with alcohol, but he didn't do cocaine or like hard drugs after that.
Okay.
But cycling kept him sober for a long time. And then in 2014, he passed away at the age of 63. So I don't know if you remember this from the documentary, but initially he was diagnosed with Parkinson's.
Mm-hmm.
We found out later that that was a misdiagnosis, that he actually had something called Lewy body dementia. And that's a type of dementia that changes your cognitive functioning, your mood, your behavior, movement. So it can look a lot like Parkinson's, but it's also marked with a lot of depression, anxiety.
That's what I remember. Yeah. There's a lot of mental health stuff.
And a lot of paranoia, too. So just like really being unwell. And so while he died by suicide, a lot of his family and friends feel like really it was the dementia piece that, that killed him. Right? Because he just was not well and he wasn't in the right state of mind, which is, I'm going to tear up if I think about it.
All right, next thing, next thing.
I love him so much. I miss him so much. He was just awesome.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Nathan Lane?
Nathan Lane.
Nathan. All right, Nathan.
Nathan.
He was actually born Joseph Lane.
Okay.
But you know how it is in the world.
Showbiz, baby.
Yeah, showbiz. Joseph Lane was taken on IMDb or whatever.
I mean,
Screen Actors Guild.
There's a porn star named Ty Hudson. I got to be careful.
Yeah, you can never be yourself.
You type in Ty Hudson, you better be careful what you're going to get back at you. So I just want to warn everybody out there.
Make sure your safe search is on. So he decided to rename himself Nathan Lane. Mm-hmm. And there is a Broadway character with the famous name is Nathan.
Nathan Detroit?
Nathan Detroit.
And Guys and Dolls.
That's exactly who he named himself
Sue me.
Who he actually goes on to play.
Yeah.
Later on.
Yeah.
And is well received as that. Which is so funny. He just, his voice is so unique. And like, you know, when I hear.
No, you're in a Nathan Lane show.
When I hear Timon. I'm like, oh, yeah.
Yep.
So he had actually already done The Lion King, the voice of Timon before this. That was in 92.
Mm-hmm.
And
92, Lion King?
Yeah. No, 93. 1993.
Are you sure?
Yeah, I just looked it up.
It wasn't 94?
Maybe it's 94.
I think it's 94.
Oh, crap. It's 94.
Okay.
Nope. Never mind. Aladdin was 92. Lion King is 94.
Yeah, because Beauty and the Beast, I think, is between them.
That makes sense. Whew. Thanks for fixing that.
I don't know. I'll look it up. Keep going.
So while he was on Broadway, he was in a show, Neil Simon's Laughter on the 23rd Floor. And
I love that show, actually.
Do you really?
That's my favorite Neil Simon.
Tell me about it.
Oh, well, I say that. I said that too exuberantly. I haven't read it for a long time.
But
it's just got really
it?
Funny banter between like a husband and wife duo.
Okay.
And it's, I thought it was really snappy.
Yeah.
And I did not like Odd Couple back in the day.
Okay.
And I think Nathan Lane's been in Odd Couple too. I
can
like picture him.
Probably.
But maybe he never was. Maybe I just thought like he'd be great in this.
He would be good in it.
But I think a lot of Neil Simons are so snappy.
Mm-hmm.
And I like that this one was in New York.
Mm-hmm.
I remember that was a part of it that I was like, oh, that's cool.
Gotcha. So that's when he was offered the role to do this. And he said it was a dream come true. He was so excited to get to do this movie.
94 for Lion King.
94 for Lion King. Oh, yeah. He says that him and Robin like to kind of compare the extra swag and bonuses that they got from being in Lion King voices. He said Robin got a Picasso and Nathan Lane got the painting where the dogs are playing poker. So some things too. He has won 3 Tonys.
Mm-hmm.
He's been nominated more than that, but has won 3 Tonys.
Yeah, what are his wins?
His wins are in A Funny Thing Happened on the Way to the Forum.
Yep. Never seen that show, actually.
No, really?
Never.
Yeah.
I tried to listen to it, and it's one of those soundtracks that you kind of get what's going on, but not completely, and it's hard to get invested
There's
in.
There's so much going on. I feel like that you'd have to see it
mm-hmm.
in order to really understand what's happening.
Yep.
Producers.
Yeah.
He was in that as well. And then I was surprised by this one, but Angels in America.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. I'm surprised by that, too. I didn't know that.
Yeah. He has the record for Emmys as far as guest actor. mm-hmm. in a series. So he's won that 8 times.
Wow. Yeah.
So that would be things like Modern Family.
Yep. I was going to say, I remember him in Modern Fam. He was really good in that. Mm-hmm.
Most recently, he won for Only Murders in the Building.
Yep.
He's in that as well. He's very, yeah. good. I think that's kind of his television niche,
yep.
is just to come in and be a character for like a little bit and then to be gone. Not a main, but just like coming in, just stealing the show for a couple of episodes.
Yep. Yeah. And he's such a big personality that I think that that's the best way to use him in anything.
Yeah.
In musicals too. Mm-hmm. In Producers. Have you ever seen his? Well, you saw the movie.
I saw the movie of Producers.
And I think that's too much. I think it's too much Nathan Lane. I'm not a Producers fan though either.
Yeah,
so it might be just more on me. But I just think it's too much Nathan Lane is a bad thing.
Mm-hmm.
This movie was like,
it teetered on it
mm-hmm. and it just barely came in what I would say under too much Nathan Lane.
Mm-hmm.
So it stayed on the good side mm-hmm. of the knife.
The straight edge.
Yep. Your journey is but on the edge of a knife. Stray but a little and you will fall. Rach, what's that from?
I don't remember.
Okay. I'm going to say it again.
Okay.
But I'm going to give you a huge hint.
Okay.
Frodo Baggins.
Oh, okay. Is it Lord of the Rings?
Which one, though?
Your favorite one?
Which one's that? Two Towers is my favorite
Two
one,
towers?
But it is not from Two Towers.
Oh,
it's from Fellowship.
That almost became a more high stakes question. Like, not which movie it was, but which one was your favorite. I thought, if I don't get this right,
well,
I'm in big trouble.
I like all of them.
I know.
And,
I know.
But right
They're
now,
all your favorite movies.
I just rewatched them a year and a half ago, and I decided Two Towers is my favorite right now.
Okay. As of today?
As of today, it still stands.
Okay.
Still Two Towers. Check in tomorrow. Might be Braveheart.
Oh, two other things about Nathan Lane. He didn't come out officially publicly until 1999.
Whoa.
Yeah, so much later. Again, I think
so
people knew. But
if you were in the LGBTQ community,
mm-hmm.
you would have thought this movie was done by two straight guys.
If you,
because Nathan Lane wasn't out.
He wasn't out publicly, but then again, in the 90s, not a lot of people were out publicly.
It's
though.
True.
It wasn't like, you're, you know, not being true to yourself. It was more of like it was a safety piece. He really
mm-hmm.
so he what prompted him to come out publicly was the Matthew Shepard killing.
Oh yeah, yep, mm-hmm. Laramie Project.
Mm-hmm. He's actually been with his partner for 18 years.
Oh okay.
Since 2015, mm-hmm. they married.
Wait,
in 2015.
18 years. Oh, okay.
They married
in
2015. Gosh, sometimes I write these things and it's like, who wrote this? 2015, he married his partner of 18 years. So
they got together like in 2005.
So they've been together a very long
time. How
old
are we in 05 when they got together, Rach?
We were 18.
Yep.
Yep.
We had just seen each other. You saw me pop out of that box in Seussical. For the first time.
So that's Nathan Lane. Anything else you want to know about him?
I
hope not, because I don't have any more notes. He's done a ton of Broadway.
He's done a ton.
I didn't even scratch the surface.
I just gave you the tops. It's like constant.
Because he's doing stuff all the time.
He has a great career.
He has all these
like guest appearances in TV and movies,
mm-hmm.
and then he has like consistent work on Broadway.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody, it just feels like the general consensus from the world is we love this guy.
I think so.
And so that's a pretty awesome position to be in.
Yeah, who doesn't want that as their legacy?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
Yep.
You know who else has a similar legacy?
Who?
Hank Azaria.
Yes, Hank Azaria.
So I was trying to Google how to say this word before, so I didn't fumble on it in this. And so let's see if I can tell you. So his lineage,
mm-hmm.
Both of his grandparents are from Greece.
Okay.
But they are Sephardic Thessalonian Jews.
Thessalonia.
No, there's no D. Thessalonian, dude.
Thessalonia.
Yeah.
I think that's a place in Greece. That's like a city. It was a city-state.
Yes.
Whew, or a region.
Really hard to say. But so he grew up speaking Ladino, which is essentially Judeo-Spanish. Oh, Judeo-Spanish.
Okay. Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
So one of the things that I thought about, you know, just as we watch films nowadays and we look at it with our current lens and
yeah,
we think,
like,
should that person
white guy
do that?
Playing some mean
and honestly,
Latino.
Like, Hank is notorious for doing voices that he shouldn't do, right? He's a Simpsons guy. He's
yep.
For those of
Tons
you don't know
Simpsons
who he is,
characters.
He does a lot of the voices on Simpsons, mm-hmm. Some that are appropriate. So Mo, Chief, comic book guy. He also does the quick shop owner,
yeah,
Pooh,
for sure.
So
yep.
A little cringy, but you know,
but,
also an amazing voice actor.
Yeah, for sure.
Yes.
Yep. It's only cringy because you know he's not Indian.
Yes.
But like, if you just listen to the voice, you're like, wow, that's really good.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
That they got an Indian actor for that.
Yeah.
But just like Short Circuit can tell you, that's not always true.
That blew my mind. We just finished Succession a couple of days ago, and watching that actor again, I just thought, oh my gosh.
And we did some impressions like as we were watching him, and we were like, oh man, I just can't believe that that's him.
I can't.
Right now.
I can't. but he actually said the voice that he used for this was his grandmother's voice.
Oh, okay.
So that's kind of who he ended up basing this character's voice off of.
Mm-hmm.
He's so silly in this. So
he's so funny.
He's the Guatemalan housemaid, manservant, housemaid. They use a couple of different terms for mm-hmm. him. Initially, he was just supposed to be the dresser for Nathan Lane's character.
Oh, just at the very beginning?
Yeah, he was just supposed to be the person who dressed Nathan Lane because the person in the play who normally plays the butler is black.
Oh,
but
okay.
They felt that was going to have maybe the racial overtones of that wouldn't mm-hmm. quite hit like it did in the 1978s, how
sure.
that kind of also played into that.
Yep.
So they decided just to combine mm-hmm. those two roles and just make him Guatemalan. And
I liked it.
Yeah.
To me, that made sense, and I thought that was really good.
Mm-hmm.
It would have been convoluted if you added another character, I think.
I think so,
yep,
yeah.
I liked it.
Yeah, because you end up having the whole, like, drag company comes up to help mm-hmm. essentially like redecorate the house before the
conservatives come in.
So
Ted Cruz comes.
So silly when you think about like they just take everything away, so it's so bare. They put like a giant crucifix up.
Yeah. At first it's a moose head.
Yeah.
And he's like, I got this moose head from downstairs. It's like, no moose heads. And yeah, then it's a big cross. And then they kind of love it. You could just tell they're like, oh, look at this place. There's nothing here. Gene Hackman's like, there's nothing here, but you have this beautiful cross on the wall.
Yeah.
Like,
I don't know if you caught this too, but the chairs that they're using are all chairs
yeah.
like from like a Catholic church
yep,
or something.
I did. There was a cross on the back of mm-hmm. one, like on the top of the like the design.
Yeah.
It was so funny.
Yeah.
I was like, oh,
it was
that's
so
amazing.
Bizarre. but some of the character pieces that Hank took into place is he essentially was told by the director that his character was based off of Judy Garland's dresser. So Judy Garland would panic before every performance, and then her dresser would panic with her, and he would panic more than her, so that then she would have to be the one to calm him down, and that was their kind of like their ritual. So, like when Hank was like, I don't really understand like the impetus, like why is my character like so crazy? He's like, oh, here's
yep.
why, like just channel Judy Garland's
yeah,
dresser.
Yeah, yep, that's awesome.
Goodbye, Armand.
Wait, Miss Albert, don't forget this. Listen, I don't want you to go.
Oh. My poor devoted Agador. I'm leaving you my stereo.
No.
My red boots.
I don't want.
And my wigs.
Which wig?
My best wigs. I won't need them where I'm going.
Oof. Yeah. Okay.
He loved to sing and dance to different like Gloria Estefan songs
yes,
and things.
For sure.
Like he was just having a ball. Like
yeah.
in every scene, he was just having a ball.
Yeah.
And there was some weird physical comedy, like with the shoes,
mm-hmm.
but it didn't bother me as much as I thought it would. So he has this moment where they make him dress up like a butler
mm-hmm.
and to serve Gene Hackman and the family, mm-hmm. the conservative family. And he's like not used to wearing shoes because
mm-hmm.
he just never wears shoes.
Yeah.
And he falls down a lot. And I thought that was going to be a stupid bit when mm-hmm. it first was introduced.
Mm-hmm.
And I ended up kind of liking it.
Yeah.
I thought it was pretty funny because
yeah.
he just does it so well. I was
mm-hmm.
like, this is good stuff.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's funny because he ends up falling an awful lot, but then I showed you that scene where Robin Williams actually biffs it too, but they ended up keeping it. It was not a planned biff because there's a part of me that thinks like, oh, this is too much like slapstick falling
mm-hmm.
humor, but that one was just so dang funny. And you can, if you know to watch for it, you can see like everyone like starts like breaking a little bit
mm-hmm.
and Robin Williams just gets in Hank Azaria's face. He's like, shut up, shut up, shut up. Other cast members, I didn't write down a whole heck of a lot other than like Calista Flockhart. This was mm-hmm. 1 year before she got Ally McBeal.
Oh, this is only a year before that?
Yeah, she's actually 28, I think, in this.
Okay.
Yeah, so yep. she's quite a bit older than she proceeds. She's mm-hmm. wafer thin. She's like, yeah,
she's just a rail. Mm-hmm. And then she's got these just big eyes.
Yes.
You notice? Like, she's like an owl in the night.
She does have really big
just,
eyes.
Like, big eyes and rail thin. I was like, wow, this is crazy.
For sure. Let's talk about favorite scenes or moments that you have.
The scene where they're like pretending Robin Williams is teaching Nathan Lane how mm-hmm. to walk like a man too.
Yes.
So the way Nathan Lane walks is kind of like penguinish mm-hmm. and he kind of waddles and he's mm-hmm. got his hands out like flat, like against the ground, like he's Tony Stark about to take off in the Iron Man suit. And he kind of waddles around like that. And then Robin Williams like tells him to do different things and gives him directions. It's just so funny because mm-hmm. Robin Williams doesn't really know what he's doing either.
Yes.
Just, he knows more,
yeah.
but not, he doesn't know exactly how to do it. And so he's trying to like figure out how to look more manly too. That whole part is just super funny.
Yeah, that's such a silly bit.
Yep. Any scene where they're like, there's coaching going on. Mm-hmm. I just loved it.
Mm-hmm. The football lingo I like too. Like, yeah. The Dolphins. How do you think I feel? Bewildered. Betrayed.
Yeah. Al, you old son of a bitch. How you doing? How do you feel about that call today? I mean, the Dolphins, 4th-and-3 play on their 30-yard line with only 34 seconds to go.
How do you think I feel? Betrayed, bewildered. Wrong response?
I'm not sure.
And then there's a moment where he's like, did I do a good job? And Robin Williams just goes, I don't know. I don't know how this conversation would go.
I feel like I've said that to you when you ask me like about certain teams or how uh-huh. do I feel about this trade? It's like, oh man, let me tell you how I feel about it. How do you think I feel? Bewildered, betrayed.
Oh man. So I loved that. And I did like when Nathan Lane comes out as the Barbara Bush character.
Oh yeah.
And mm-hmm. like so they're waiting for the birth bomb mm-hmm. to arrive at the dinner mm-hmm. and then Nathan Lane can show up as the uncle. Mm-hmm. Like that's the whole thing. That's the plan. Well, she gets stuck in traffic so she can't show up mm-hmm. on time. And that role is played by the Selma Blair's mom in Cruel Intentions.
Oh, she's so famous.
She's in Mamma Mia. She plays, what's the role that you were up for in Mamma Mia?
I don't remember.
the slutty one, the slutty mom in Mamma Mia. And so she plays all these great characters mm-hmm. and she's it once again in this, but then she can't make it. She gets stuck in traffic. Mm-hmm. And then Nathan Lane comes out as that in that drag outfit. Mm-hmm. And Gene Hackman is so taken with her. He just thinks she's the best. And like she's like a real woman. And you can almost tell like there's not a whole lot of love in his current marriage. Mm-hmm. But he's kind of falling for her, yes. It feels like.
Yes.
And it just makes it so funny. Mm-hmm. The reveal is going to be that that's actually a man, Ted Cruz. Like mm-hmm. you're not falling in love with a woman. It's another man. Yeah, it just like intensifies that.
Well, even just the things that they're saying at dinner that she's saying, Nathan Lane is saying at yeah. dinner are just like, she just keeps agreeing with things, but then like taking it to yep. the next notch. Yeah,
they
like,
talk about abortion. She says, don't kill the doctors, kill the moms.
And then he's like, yeah, okay. He's like, just like, what? The things that she's saying are like, that's wild.
That's so crazy. One of my favorite parts is they're looking at the bookcase, mm-hmm. and all that's on the bookcase is the entire Nancy Drew collection.
Yes. Oh, these old books. What are they? Oh, Nancy Drew.
Yeah, the whole collection. And then Gene Hackman comments on it. He's like, I just love this place. It's bare bones, all you not pretentious books, the cross on the wall. Like, yeah. Those same things. He just loves it.
And then during the big reveal, he has such a hard time, like, figuring out, like, coming to grips with when they take Nathan Lane's wig off.
Yeah.
He's like, I don't get it.
Yeah.
I don't get it.
He almost just thinks, like, is this a woman who cuts her hair really short and puts a wig on because she has short, dark hair?
Yeah.
Like, he's just confused.
He's so hurt. One of my favorite lines is when... Robin Williams is trying to basically get Nathan Lane not to go back up to the apartment because it's getting redecorated and he wants to like keep him out. He's saying things like, you look tired, let's go shopping. Mm-hmm. Let's. And then Nathan Lane's line is like, you look tired means you look old. You look rested means you've had collagen.
Yep.
Oh, so silly.
There's a ton of those little snappy one-liners.
Yes.
I like was going to start writing some down and they're just so fast. Mm-hmm. I couldn't remember them. And I was like, oh shoot, I don't even remember what the setup line was. Mm-hmm. And so I didn't end up writing any of them down, but mm-hmm. there's just so many quotable lines mm-hmm. in this movie though, too.
Very much. Other things from your viewing, what are things you saw?
Yeah. We talked about the beginning, that opening shot, mm-hmm. but I also thought what the beginning reminded me of and other moments in this movie is this is gay Scarface.
Huh. Gay it's Scarface.
Miami. Say. It looks just like Scarface. There's so many scenes with like people rollerblading in their bikinis and their Speedos and stuff. But there's a gay veneer over Scarface. That's pretty much what this movie is.
That's pretty much.
Yeah.
Say hello.
And then I did like, do you remember what Nathan Lane's drag character's name is?
Starina.
Oh. Just beautiful.
Yeah. Did you like the little bit that you got to watch of that?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. I love the...
Definitely. Well, because here's the thing. Mm-hmm. We talk about drag shows. Mm-hmm. And one of the things So I understand why it happens. Because mm-hmm. they dance and move unlike... With the athleticism, unlike anything you've ever seen before. Mm-hmm. Like, good drag stars
yeah.
are like super athletes. Mm-hmm. Like, they're incredible.
Yeah. For sure.
But the one thing that's always thrown me off is the lip-syncing part. Mm-hmm. I've always yeah. felt like, why don't you just dance to the song? Mm-hmm. And you don't even have to mouth the words.
Yeah.
Or why don't you like tone down the dancing and sing the song? Being from a musical theater person, that's mm-hmm. what I've always thought, like, you should go one way or the other. But like, it's its own thing. You just mm-hmm. have to take it as at its own thing. Mm-hmm. But what I loved about Nathan Lane is Nathan Lane like did a one-man show pretty much,
yeah,
one-woman show.
Sings it.
It sings, acts, like everything is actually him. And it's, so it's really kind of a brilliant one-man show.
Yeah, I love the rehearsal scene with the guy as they're rehearsing a new song and he keeps popping his gum.
Yep.
Armand, did you see what he just did? Hello, Valley, darling.
What did he do?
He blew a bubble with his gum while I was singing. He can't do that while I'm singing.
He's chewing gum. He popped a bubble in my face.
Oh, well, I had this written down, but I don't even know what I mean, but I'm going to say it to you, and maybe you'll figure it out. Lane reading the memento book. Oh, it's the book of pictures of the sun.
Oh.
And he just keeps crying after he finds out that he's getting married. He's like, oh, there he is. He's going to his bar mitzvah year. And oh my gosh. He just keeps crying over and over again.
He's so sweet.
It's
so
really funny because he loves him so much.
He does.
And that's an interesting dynamic. I think, mm-hmm. can we touch on this for a little bit?
Let's get into that.
So I don't like the son character.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think he's forgivable.
Hmm.
I understand. Like, I wish he was more likable in his whole, dad, like, I really love her. And I think I'm going to lose her. Like, it's almost mm-hmm. partly on the script, but it's also on the actor.
Sure.
That there needed to be more of, I love you and I love her.
Mm-hmm.
And can we please do something so then I can get married to her?
Mm-hmm.
Like, can you help me out?
Yeah.
And I never felt like it got to that. It was more like, dad, you need to hide all your gayness.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you're too gay.
Yeah.
And it was in a nicer way than that,
mm-hmm.
but it was always just tiptoeing around like kind of a more harsh, like, you guys are too gay,
mm-hmm.
shove away your gayness for one night for me,
mm-hmm.
so then I can trick these parents into like accepting me as their son.
Mm-hmm.
And there wasn't enough love
sure.
from him.
Mm-hmm.
There was enough love coming from Robin Williams
mm-hmm.
and especially from Nathan Lane,
mm-hmm.
but there wasn't enough love for him for his parents.
Mm-hmm.
And we missed a lot of stuff. And so I just felt like he was almost unforgivable. And then at the end, he finally has like a big moment with a reveal where he pulls Nathan Lane's wig off to
mm-hmm.
show like, hey,
this is
my actual mom.
Mm-hmm.
So he has a moment,
mm-hmm.
but there wasn't enough little stuff before that I just thought like, dude, you caused like irreparable damage though.
Mm-hmm.
Like some of the things you've said and some of the things you've done
mm-hmm.
are just too far without enough love that the only reason your dads are doing this is because they have unconditional love for you.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't like you.
Yeah. I think the hard part is if you put maybe too much love and understanding beforehand, then that character doesn't get as big of an arc.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, no, I agree. It hurt my heart watching it. I didn't remember that when I watched it when I was younger, but
mm-hmm.
I think being older now and then just what that would mean to have like your son disown you, essentially.
Yeah.
Especially in this time and age. But mm-hmm. And maybe a part of that's with the time, too. It was just kind of common, like, you need to hide that because it's not wildly accepted mm-hmm. outside of South Beach. Yeah, I don't know. I don't disagree.
Yeah.
But I did like, it does make the ending more meaningful when the son says, like, this is my mother. This is who raised me.
Yeah.
And these this is my family.
I think part of it might have also been the son had about as much charisma as like a brick of concrete. Like it was not an impressive performer. I just thought he was so boring.
Sure.
And like even Clarissa Flockhart.
Yeah.
Calista mm-hmm. had a lot more personality than he did. That I was just so. Like, he's just so like paint dry. Mm-hmm. Watching paint dry right now. Mm-hmm. That it's just like, ugh. There's just no. Nothing to be interested in yeah. this character.
I think especially with the backdrop of Robin Williams and Nathan Lane
yeah.
and all that's happening with that, it's like, yeah, you're just kind of boring.
You can be subtle and charming. Mm-hmm. Like, I understand that you're not going to want to get on their level because you're never going to get to that level.
Yeah.
Your character doesn't demand that. You mm-hmm. need to be somewhat of a grounded like contrast
yeah,
to them.
Yeah, you need to serve the play.
But you can still have a glimmer of spark.
Charm.
Yeah, some sort of charm mm-hmm. about you. Yeah. And this guy had zero charm.
Yeah.
I want to look up what other things that guy did because I'm just like, how did you land this? Were you like a producer's kid? Or like, who are you?
Good questions. Don't know.
I had the bubblegum section as well. Penis statues we already talked about. There's just sure. so many penis statues.
There's just a lot
and
of gay
that
stuff.
Was one of the funny things is when the son is going around the room and pointing out things that are really gay mm-hmm. in the space mm-hmm. and Robin Williams is trying to defend them. He's like, that's art.
That's a classic. All right. Oh, we didn't touch on this. The bowls. At
yes,
dinner,
yes,
yep. other like artifacts at home. So there's these Greek style bowls. There's a scene happening, and it's all men, and it's so funny. They keep
all men that are like pretty much in the act of fornication.
Yeah,
yep.
And Nathan Lane is realizing like, oh, these bowls. I've never seen these bowls. No, I have girls on mine. Don't you have girls?
Yeah.
On yet?
Oh, I think that's a girl right there.
And she's like, quick, put the soup in
yep.
to cover it.
Oh man, that was so funny. Oh, we never talked about the coaching part. One thing I loved was Nathan Lane just can't keep his pinky down.
No.
Whenever he takes a drink of something or sure. grabs something. And Robin Williams throughout that whole pinky scene, like at first they're distinctively trying to get the pinky down, mm-hmm. but it almost feels a little ad-libby where like there's other things he goes to do later in the scene and mm-hmm. that pinky floats back up and Robin Williams just smacks him on the hand and just goes, pinky! It's so funny.
Yeah, I have to believe that that's probably one of those in-between takes. And so we were ad-libbing yep. a little bit.
Yep.
And, yeah, for sure.
And then the last thing that I have written down, mm-hmm. and then we can go back to your format, mm-hmm. is We Are Family is a mm-hmm. terrible song. It is awful. It's like you never know how bad it is until you have to listen to it mm-hmm. on repeat literally twice in this movie, and it goes for like 5 minutes each time, and they just keep singing We Are Family, and I can't listen to that song ever again. Like, that's horrible.
It's so crazy.
I've never been stuck in a place and had to hear it for that long. As I've always turned the radio station, that is an awful song.
Mm, mm-hmm. Not a fan.
Not a fan at all.
Sister Sledge, I believe.
Oh, yeah? Well, it's, yeah, shameful rendition. But I like the drag. I like the point of it.
Yes. Yeah.
Is that, you know, we're all
But as a song, there's not much going on there, is
no,
there?
No, it's just over and over and over again.
It's a lot of repeats.
Yep.
Great segue, because that takes me to the soundtrack.
Oh, yeah.
So the film's composer, Jonathan Tunick, actually adapted a lot of music from Stephen Sondheim.
Oh.
And Stephen Sondheim.
We Are Family is
Stephen Sondheim? No, that was really the only one. And then the Gloria Estefan stuff, which are two of the more memorable songs from this. Mm-hmm. But Stephen Sondheim also allowed them to use several of his songs that were cut from other shows.
Oh, I wonder if that Nathan Lane song that he sings.
Ah, great question. Which one are you talking about?
The one when during the one-man show?
The Little Dreams?
Yeah, yeah.
It's called Little Dream, and it was composed for this show.
Oh,
Stephen
fine.
Sondheim created that for it. Also, there's another show, It Takes All Kinds. I'm wondering if that was the song that the mom and Armand are singing together.
Oh,
in
they
the
have
office?
A little dance number that they do.
Yeah,
yep.
they do like as they're like reconnecting a little bit.
Yep.
It looks Yeah, it's a cute little like number that they're doing. I think that was also a Stephen Sondheim original there as well. Other ones that they have. Oh, no. Love is in the Air. That's never mind. That was a song. Love is in the Air is a song that they're playing.
Mm-hmm.
And that was from A Funny Thing Happened on the Way to the Forum. But it's extra music from that. I don't think it's in the original.
Okay.
I'm not 100% sure, though, because I've only seen that play one time.
You saw the play.
I did. I have seen it before.
How was it?
It was okay.
Just okay.
I saw it at like Iowa State.
0 to 10.
How was the play?
Yeah, 0 to 10.
Oh,
just go off your gut. Five.
Five always feels
pure
good.
Pure out of five.
Five.
That's such a safe answer.
It is.
It's
really
not bad.
Is.
It's not good. It's a five.
It just was. It just was. And then the last song that they used, I don't remember when this one was used, but it's called Can That Boy Foxtrot? And that was cut from Follies.
Oh, gotcha.
Apparently.
Okay.
So, yeah, you talk about the music, but, you know, Stephen Sondheim had a lot to do with that.
Yeah.
Minus the song that you didn't like. Let's talk budget.
Yes.
The budget for this was $31 million. U.S. opening week, which was March 1996, mm-hmm. it made $18
million. Oh, okay.
So pretty good for an opening week.
Yeah.
It was number one for 3 weeks.
Oh, that's really good.
It is really good, especially with it being around the material that it was about.
Yeah, for sure.
It's pretty cool.
Mm-hmm.
It was dethroned by Primal Fear.
Oh, Primal Fear. You've never seen it. It's on our Summer's Off list.
Oh,
that movie, Rach, is going to blow your mind.
Oh, I hope it does. I hope it does. Who's in Primal Fear?
Richard Gere. Edward Norton.
Okay.
Young that's Edward fun. Norton. Baby Edward Norton.
Ooh, cute.
Yeah, you won't think that soon enough.
Uh-oh. Ended up worldwide making $185 million. So she was a smash.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, both at home and internationally. Mm-hmm. This was a big hit. Awards. It was nominated for Best Art Direction for an Academy Award.
Okay.
I don't know what Best Art Direction is. Is that just the vibe of
I don't know either. Probably set, I don't know, set dressing and stuff?
Yeah, I'm not sure.
I don't know.
I should know what that is. It won a SAG Award for Best Cast.
Okay.
So Best Cast, that's essentially Best Picture, isn't
it?
It
is,
for
the SAGs. That's mm-hmm. a really important award.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Nominated for Best Supporting Actress for SAGs that same year were both Nathan Lane and Hank Azaria. They were both nominated.
For Best Actress?
For Best Supporting.
Best Supporting Actress, though?
Actor.
Oh, actor.
No.
Oh,
did
okay.
I say actress?
Yeah. I was, maybe you didn't. Maybe I just heard it. But I was like, wait, what?
No. Wait, what?
That's very forward thinking.
Globe, it was nominated for Best Comedy. Nathan Lane was also nominated. And then MTV Movie Awards.
Of course.
Nominated
Bring home
for the
those
best
popcorns,
duo.
Baby.
Yes, Best Duo for Robin Williams and Nathan Lane.
Okay. They probably lost to Save the Last Dance.
96? I don't
know. No, that's too early.
Too early.
Yep.
Good guess, though. some reviews. Both hilarious and politically incisive, The Birdcage, a remake of the 1978 French farce Le Cage aux Folies, stands up surprisingly well through a modern lens.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't write who that was from.
Oh, that's not the consensus?
That's not the consensus.
Oh, okay.
Nope, that's just somebody random's
somebody.
Review.
Ain't it cool news?
I didn't write it. Another one that I didn't write the author of. It undoubtedly remains a genial crowd pleaser. If the dress fits, wear it.
If the dress fits, wear it.
Nope. No name. Anonymous. the GLAAD Foundation, GLAAD stands for mm-hmm. Gay and Lesbian Alliance Against Defamation, praised the film for going beyond the stereotypes to see the character's depth and humanity. The film celebrates differences and points out the outrageousness of hiding those differences.
Mm-hmm.
I'm glad that GLAAD likes it. You never know. Like when you talk about stereotypes, it's like, I know there are some in it, but I think it does a really good job at acknowledging that. But then also, like it says, it gets at the heart of it mm-hmm. too.
Well, now Robin Williams and Hank Azaria would get destroyed for this movie.
They probably would.
That would, yeah. But it's, hopefully people can just take it as a reflection of the time mm-hmm. and that we don't have to destroy the movie now.
Yeah. Oh, I hope not.
Yeah. That'd be stupid.
Yeah. All right. Now critics' consensus.
Yeah.
Okay. Mike Nichols wrangles agreeable, amusing performances from Robin Williams and Nathan Lane in this fun, if not essential, remake of the French comedy Le Cage aux Folies.
Mm-hmm.
Rotten Tomatoes score, 83%.
Oh, okay.
Audience, 81%.
Oh.
Ty Hudson says...
Oh, it's my time.
It's your turn.
It's time. It's time. Robin Williams is a soaring eagle. And Nathan Lane is a squawking pelican in all the best ways. This movie mostly will leave you chirping, but a few laid eggs keep it from greatness. 75%. Tied with My Big Fat Greek Wedding, The Predator, and The Crow.
Ooh.
Another bird film.
Another bird.
And I'm just going to say this already. Pelican Brief. Another tie.
Another bird film. Nice, so you liked it.
75%. I enjoyed myself.
That's solid.
Yep, I thought the comedy was great. I mm-hmm. thought our leads were fantastic.
Mm-hmm.
Like I said, Nathan Lane, there were a couple moments where I was like, especially at the beginning, mm-hmm. I was like, oh, is this going to be too much?
Mm-hmm.
Am I going to get annoyed with Nathan Lane?
Mm-hmm.
And every time I thought we were going there, we never got there. Mm-hmm. We never went past the line, and I always stayed in enjoyable territory.
Mm-hmm.
So I ended up thinking it was a great performance.
Right on that knife's edge.
Yep. Robin Williams, fantastic mm-hmm. acting in this movie. Found moments to be funny, mm-hmm. but in general, I would say played more subdued than you'd think he would.
Yeah.
Like if you handed him this role, you'd think like, oh, he's going to be bigger. Like
mm-hmm.
on the page.
Mm-hmm.
Like that's what I would assume as the director. I'd be like, yeah he's going to be a little bigger. I mean, I probably have to maybe tone him down.
Mm-hmm.
And he's actually more toned down mm-hmm. than I thought he would be.
Yeah. Yeah, he is a very generous scene partner,
mm-hmm.
I think, in
yep.
a lot of the scenes. And he kind of lets Hank Azaria and Nathan Lane shine a little bit
yep.
more than he would normally in those roles.
Mm-hmm. I think Hank is absolutely hysterical. Every time he's on the screen, I was laughing my ass off. I just thought he was just the bee's knees.
Yeah.
The kids or whatever. Gene Hackman, I wish that they gave him more like funny stuff to do because mm-hmm. he's a great actor.
Mm-hmm.
But in general, I don't think he gets like a ton of great source material until he's like in front of Nathan Lane.
Mm-hmm.
And then
yeah.
all of a sudden it's great.
Yeah.
But before that, he's just like kind of a throwaway.
Yeah. I don't think about his character much until they're at dinner.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Which is great.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So in general, I think the movie's really, really good.
Yeah.
Super fun.
Yay. This was a fun rewatch.
Mm-hmm.
As I was doing the...
Better than It Takes Two, you think?
You think?
You think it's better?
Do you think? Yeah. Way better. Yes. As I was doing the research for this, I was not nervous. I thought, oh, I'm excited to show you this film.
Because yeah.
this is a fun film. You need to know it. It's just, yeah, it's a good time. I would give it, I'm high as well. I gave it an 87.
Okay.
So that is near Braveheart and Count of Monte Cristo. It's a little sandwich there.
Oh,
like
fun.
That? That's fun. The whole
yeah.
season right there.
Whole season.
In one bite.
Season. A lot of high 80s for Rach or 100%.
Or zeros.
Or, yeah, whatever.
Near zeros.
Yeah.
The bird.
You've been just
the
shitting on all my movies. The only movie.
No, that's not
the
true.
The only movie you were critical of yourself was It Takes Two.
That's true. That was a terrible movie.
Yeah, it was awful.
And it
and
ruined
you know what?
The day.
I actually was going through my scores, and I think I had it above Crossroads. I'm going to just go on the record right now and say I'm moving it below Crossroads. I've thought about it more. Crossroads mm-hmm. is definitely a better movie than It Takes Two. It Takes Two is awful.
I can't believe I had to try to convince you.
No,
this.
You shouldn't have, and I'm ashamed of myself.
I'm mad at me,
I'm
mostly.
Yeah, but I'm also mad at you for not convincing me more.
Oh, Ty, it's our last episode.
It's episode 9.
Oh,
episode 10 is next week. This is crazy.
End of an era, or just a season, but whatever. It's the end of it.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Okay.
Rach.
What are you going to take us out on?
We are going to exit
mm-hmm.
the season
mm-hmm.
by going backwards.
Mm-hmm.
It's good to move forwards, but sometimes you have to reflect a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes by that reflection, that means that you have to go back in time, maybe meet your mom, maybe make out with her.
No,
maybe.
What?
Oh, I don't know. Maybe. I said maybe.
Oh, I hope not.
Maybe become best friends with your dad.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe see what a weirdo they both are. I don't know. There's a lot of things you're maybe going to have to do and you're going to confront in your own past. I just want you to think about that this week.
Okay.
Think about what would your parents be like in high school? Because next week, we are going back to the future. Let's do another sound check. Let me list off the bands for you. I don't think you realize who's in the bands. You literally had the audacity to say, this concert's not as cool as my sister's wedding. So here we go. Headliner, All American Rejects. Mm-hmm. Then it's Newfound Glory. Mm-hmm. Then it's Starting Line, my favorite band of all time. Mm-hmm. Not of all time anymore, but in high school, mm-hmm. in early college. Mm-hmm. And then it's Get Up Kids. So you're going to go emo, pop emo, or pop punky emo. Then you're going to go pop punk, and then pop punky emo again. It's going to be amazing. Do you wish to rebuttal? Do you wish to take it all back?
I regret nothing.